I just want to acknowledge, well, I'll put it this way. When I was growing up until I was 11, I lived in the city of Flint, Michigan. And everything in Flint, Michigan, every store, every industry, every creative firm, they were all tied to the auto industry. And when the auto industry would go through problems or strikes, it would be very hard on the city and the people living in it. And I just want to acknowledge this morning that I know a majority of us in this room, living here in the Washington area, when something goes on with the federal government, we feel that in our minds and in our hearts. It might even be affecting our jobs right now. And I just want to say that we're praying for you as the government tries to find a resolution on this budget, if it's weighing on your mind. And I thought it might be good if we just, before we get into the message today, just say a quick word of prayer for our leaders. Let's pray. God, you said in the book of Timothy that we're to pray for our leaders, to pray for those in authority that we might live lives of peace. It's so easy to become apathetic about the political machine. It's so easy to lose faith in those that are leading us. But you ask us to pray. And so this morning we ask that you give guidance to those that lead us, that they would guide our country into the way of fairness and equality for all people, that people and their lives would come first with the budget that's being discussed and all of the laws that are in place. God, we pray that you would open the hearts of our leaders to see people, to see their constituents, and to act on their behalf. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, serious part's over. Now I'll do some jokes. Well, it may surprise you to hear it, but you know, we just did the passing of the peace, which, by the way, I think Kenny needs to preach some. That kid is good behind the microphone. It may surprise you to hear this, but each week during the passing of this peace, I get very stressed out. And it's not just because I'm an introvert. It's not that I don't like talking to people. It stresses me out because it's like trying to cram an hour's worth of conversation into a few seconds. It just really rapid fires. Peace be with you. Also with you. How are you doing? I'm good. How are you doing? Is that a new shirt? Yeah, I got it at H&M on sale. It looks nice. What are you going to do this? Oh, wait, we have to stop talking. They're getting ready to read the scripture. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Bam, 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 bam. It just, it's too fast for me, man. There's just too many people to get to. But every now and then, during the passing of the peace, that time is redeemed, and someone will ask me a question that I know that I can't answer in a matter of seconds, and that's a very good thing because it gives me something to write about. One of the questions that has been coming up from more of you than I can count over the last few weeks is about a topic that we often shy away from, myself included, the topic of sin. And I would probably never speak on this topic were you guys not to have asked me about it. So thank you, Gary, for asking me that all those weeks. I need it. But maybe you want to know what sin is. So, but why would we talk about that in church? I mean, it's kind of a downer thing, right? Who wants to hear about sin? But I'm glad that many of you asked, because as I was studying and restudying some passages I hadn't looked at in a long time this past week, I was reminded of some things that I needed to remember. What is sin? When is something wrong? What is displeasing to God? The answer to this question might seem like an easy one, but the more you think about it, the more complex that it gets. The story of Genesis that we just heard has a lot about it in our topic for today that we often overlook, maybe because of how we were raised or how we were taught or because we just have never seen it in the passage before. But it addresses the topic of sin with crystal clarity. Many of us know the story, whether you believe it to be literal or figurative is beside the point. The lesson housed in the story is why it matters. These two first people, these two characters in the story, Adam and Eve, are in this beautiful garden named Eden. And it's a fantastic place. Things grow spontaneously up out of the ground, and the animals all get along with one another, and no one's harming anyone, no one's stealing, no one's lying. Everything exists in a state of perfect harmony. It is utopia in the purest sense of the word. But because God gives free will to his creatures, he leaves one tree in the center of the garden, and he tells Adam and Eve, you can eat from any tree that you want except for that tree in the middle of the garden. I have to give you the option to disobey me, otherwise you're just my puppets. So go forage and ride on elephants and enjoy the garden. And here's what the text says happens in the story. It says, when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. So right off the bat, a couple of things. Sin, if you think about it, temptation, etc., usually begins with a response to a valid need or want. In this instance, Eve sees this fruit, and it looks delicious, like we think of when we look at an apple or a pomegranate or a mango. And she also realizes there's something that I don't know that God didn't tell me, and the eating of this fruit is going to give me that wisdom. So she's wanting wisdom. And wanting food and wanting wisdom are very good things to want. In fact, you can't get through life without those things. If you don't eat and you don't learn, you're not going to be alive very long, and you're not going to be very successful in the world. So why Eve wants what she wants is right and good. But what she wants and the way she wants to get it is something that's forbidden. So Eve is wanting all the right things, but then she tries to get those things the wrong way. And watch what happens after Adam and Eve eat the fruit. It says, then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. That would be terrible, by the way, if you just, like, you didn't know you were naked and you were walking around and you just are on the street and oh my gosh, I didn't know I was naked. That would be horrifying. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day or the breeze of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man and said, where are you? The man answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. Then God said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? And the man said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it. Maybe more than any other allegory, any other story, this story is a perfect example what it is like for us when we sin, when we make mistakes. The house lights come up and all of the dust and all of the cobwebs are exposed, and we want to hide because we're ashamed of what we did. And this is what sin does in the life of human beings. It makes us want to hide. It makes us fearful. It makes us want to cover up the parts of ourselves that we don't want anyone to see or know about. And it causes division between us and those that we love. And so we see from this first story, this earliest of stories, maybe not so much a definition of what sin is, but certainly how we can identify it in our lives. Anything that makes us afraid of God and afraid of one another is sinful. Anything that makes us want to hide and that puts wedges between people is wrong. Adam and Eve sin, and the next thing you know, they're hiding, they're ashamed, and there's division between them. Adam doesn't even call Eve by her name. He objectifies her in the moment and says, it's that woman that you put here. Fear, shame, covering up, hiding, blame. These are sin's identifiers. What I have learned over the years as a human being with valid needs and wants, and being duped into meeting those needs and wants with unhealthy methods, trying my best to live and work inside of this tradition that often demands this confusing blend of grace and perfection from me. What I have learned is that in my mistakes, just like in this story, God always comes looking for me. And he's not looking for me to punish me and to harm me, but to help me fix it. I thought I'd have worn out that kind of love and patience by now, but time after time, God's love and patience remain infinite. And what has become so helpful to me practically over the years is to ask myself some questions based on this passage before I engage in anything. Questions like, do I have to hide in order to engage in this? Do I have to do this in secret? Is this something that's good for me and good for the world? Is this something that makes me afraid of God and afraid of other people and suspicious of the people in my life that love me? Is this something that brings me closer to those that I love, or something that puts a wedge between us? Does this bring dignity, or does it bring disorder? C.S. Lewis once wrote this about sin. It would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling around with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. Lewis names some common things that we struggle with: drink, sex, ambition. Add whatever else you desire to that list. The truth is, though, that if you really boil it down to its source, none of these things are wrong in and of themselves. In fact, they are godly wants and desires. The desire to be close to someone and have intimacy with someone, that's a very good thing. The desire to relax at the end of a long day, that's a good thing. The desire to be busy and do good work in the world. That's a good thing. But it's how we go about getting those things that matters. Do we love or do we lust? Do we drink or do we drown ourselves? Do we pursue our goals or do we make gods out of them? Why is it bad to meet our desires in an unhealthy way? Because it hurts us, it hurts people, and it hurts the world. It's not just a bunch of rules for rules' sake. It's because God wants people to be well. And it's okay if you're here this morning and you make mistakes. I personally have never made a mistake in my life, but for the rest of you, I'm kidding. You're okay. You're going to be okay, and you're going to make mistakes. It's going to get the best of you, no matter how hard you try. And just when you think you have it all together and all fixed, it'll find a way to dupe you again. The key is to just keep asking yourself brutally honest questions. Don't fake your way through this. You are better than that. And when you make a mistake, whatever that is, it's different for all of us. When you make a mistake, just talk to God about it. If you've made a mistake that involves the hurting of someone else, just talk to them about it. Don't run and hide. Don't minimize. Don't cover up and blame. God already knows. And he comes looking for us anyway. I do this on a regular basis in my life. It seems like almost every day, the quiet spots of my life, places where I find myself alone in an elevator or in the bathroom or in the shower or my kitchen early in the morning when I'm making coffee. Sometimes when I have those quiet moments, I'm confronted with my mistakes. My mind fills up with all that I haven't done right, or perhaps something that I've done for myself at the expense of another person, been less than myself as a human being. And in these moments, I pause and I just take a second to get honest. And it's still, after so many years being a pastor, is weird for me to talk out loud to God, but I do it anyway. And I just say, yeah, God, I did it. It was me, Ryan, your wayward child, and I'm ashamed, and I want to hide, and I'm afraid to tell you about it. You've given me no reason to be afraid of you, and I don't know why I'm hiding and why I want to just cover this up. So I'm just talking to you. Here I am, and I'm sorry. And when I do that, something always shifts for me inside. Frederick Buechner wrote this once about confession. He said, "To confess your sins to God is not to tell God anything that God doesn't already know. Until you confess them, however, they are the abyss between you. But when you confess them, they become the Golden Gate Bridge." My prayer for our community a lot, and my prayer for myself, is that we would ever be becoming more vulnerable people. Not in a self-deprecating sort of way, but just people who are transparent. I'll give you some dirt on me for a second. I have a few mentors in my life that I will see from time to time, and they will call me out on my stuff. And a few months back, one of them said to me, you know, you're standing here, you're looking at me, you're speaking, your mouth is moving, but you are just closed off. You're not being open. And I want to be less of that in my life and be more of a person that people can see into. And what's more, I want to be a person that's courageous enough to let other people see into me. And it's so hard. We can get so programmed in the world because we live in a time and a culture where folks around us might often be so judgmental, and we're afraid to let people see our stuff. But that doesn't have to be that way in this community. This community can be a safe haven from that. And wherever you are in your life today, whatever you're struggling with, and I'm obviously not talking about, like, forgive me, this is graphic. I'm not talking about if you're, like, murdering people and hiding portions of them in your freezer. Like, please don't go to someone after church and say, hey, I'm killing people in front. Not that kind of stuff. If you tell somebody that, we're calling the police. But these things, these little things that we struggle with, the thoughts that we have that are less than wholesome, the judgments that we hold on to about others, there's something helpful about talking to one another about that. The book of James says, confess your faults to one another that you might be healed. And we can make that a practice here in our community where we lean on one another and we share with one another and no one's alarmed. And there's no judgment. In fact, it brings us closer together because we realize we're not all alone in the things that we struggle with. As we go out from this place this week, let's practice that. Whether that's through our emails or we're hanging out with one another, let's practice that vulnerability. People who certainly have a past, but who in the present choose to be unashamed and unafraid because of a love that is bigger than we can possibly imagine. Let's stand and pray. Almighty God, we are programmed to project images of ourselves that are often not who we really are. We touch up our photos, we say things on social media that are over the top and may not really be us. And all of this comes from the pressure to appear as something we feel is expected of us. Would you ingrain into our hearts the realization and the truth that what you expect of us is to simply be who we are on the way to where we are going. Not as an excuse, not to minimize, not to say that making mistakes don't matter, but forgive us for the times where we place far too much emphasis on our mistakes and far too little emphasis on your grace and your forgiveness and your love. Help us to receive that deeply within ourselves so that we might extend that to others. So that we might be beacons and lighthouses of transparency and hope and authenticity in the world. We ask these things in Jesus' name.